Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. My name is Katie Rowley. I'm with the NOAA Central Library, and I'm very excited to share some tips and tools from AGU and Wiley today about getting your work published and discovered. First up, some logistics. If you have trouble hearing or seeing the slides today, try logging off of GoToWebinar and back in. That solves most of the issues. We are taking questions today. There will be a chance at the midpoint of the presentation to ask questions, and there will be a chance at the end. We are going to be doing a couple polls as well, so look out for those. Lastly, we are recording this. So if you miss it, if you want to share this with a colleague later on, it'll be up on the library's YouTube channel by tomorrow. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to our speakers today, Hannah Smith and Robert Pincus, for them to introduce themselves and get started.
Thanks, Katie. I'll hand it over to you, Robert, to introduce yourself first, and then I'll introduce myself.
So my name is Robert Pincus. I have a joint appointment at the University of Colorado and at NOAA's Physical Sciences, or newly renamed Physical Sciences Lab. I'm coming to you live from my living room with my children behind me. I'm the editor-in-chief of AGU's Journal on Modeling. So this is the Journal of Advances in Modeling Earth Systems, where I've been editor-in-chief for about 6 years. So I have seen all of the publication process that a scientist normally sees. And I'm here to talk to you about how to make that process easier for you.
Great. And I'm Hannah Smith. I'm a publisher with Wiley. I work in the Food, Earth, and Environmental Sciences team at Wiley, and I work closely with the AGU and on a couple of other titles at Wiley as well. All right. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to you, Robert, and you'll cue me when you want to change over the slides.
Sounds great. Let's start. Yeah. A word of warning to the attendees, most of these slides I'm well versed in, but not every single one of them. So can you move to the next one, Hannah? Right, so here is simply to orient you to what we intend to talk about, this first question, why publish, which where we won't spend very much time. Then I wanted to sort of share with you the what I and my fellow editors have learned over time in the sense of how to structure, how to think about the publication process and the writing of a manuscript in a way that will make it less painful. And then we will switch and Hannah will talk about these last two points, open practices, which I think will, open practices and how to promote your work and maximize your impact. Go ahead. Maybe this question seems obvious to you and maybe not, but why should you publish? There's a couple different things. I'll add one at the end as well. So there's recognition, right? Publishing is the currency by which we often measure scientists. Now that's more strictly true for academic scientists than for agency scientists, but it's true in general. If you're doing good work, you would like your peers to know about it. That will lead to career development, of course, like promotions and raises. And at some level, I think this is important to take seriously as well. You know, we are paid by taxpayer dollars. Most taxpayers make less than most of us. We have a responsibility to report what it is we have learned and make that public. And I take that quite seriously. And the one that I would add that's not on the slide is that publishing often helps you make sense of your own work in the same way that writing a proposal might do. So it helps you to organize your thinking. It helps you to know what it is you might want to do next. So next slide. You know, on the other hand, one does not want to be a slave to publication, particularly in an agency, it is not necessarily publish or perish. And so, you know, roughly speaking, you can think of two different kinds of publications. One is something original that you have learned or done, which is new and which is interesting. And that can, of course, range from a new idea, a new method, a new algorithm, a new measurement, right? Anything which is novel and which adds to the field. And the other is work that is synthesis. And these, of course, are not, you know, it's not one thing or the other. Most papers contain elements of both of these things. But some kind of synthesis where you, synthesis and emphasis where you have learned something by mostly by considering what other people have done in the past. So the goal of the work is not to advance your career, but rather to advance knowledge and understanding, to advance the community of practice in which we work. Of course, that means that what you will publish will not be out of date, and it's rarely all that interesting to simply redo someone else's calculation with your model or your method. Okay, maybe we will move on next, because we'll cover some of these points again. So here is some insight gleaned from a bunch of conversations with several editors across AGU and other journals. So let's go ahead. So the first few slides are about how to think about a manuscript that you are preparing for publication. I think they apply equally well to if you're giving talks or writing reports. But the first thing you want to do is think about this as a narrative. You want to tell a story, and you want to tell that story in context. So one way that I often say this is that people want to know what you have learned and not what you have done. So you want to understand, really, before you start writing the paper, what message you want people to take away from that paper. And then you want to build the paper explicitly around that message. If you have material that is related to the work that you did, but that does not tell the story, I'm sorry, you should probably remove it. Save it for another paper or find a way to weave it into the story. But human readers, like all human beings, are looking for stories that organize their thinking. So there should be a narrative, right? There should be a beginning, a middle, and an end. There should be a description of, what the general problem is, and then what the specific problem is that you went and made the measurements or decided to try a different approach addresses. I said this thing about talking about what you learned and not what you did. You want to be explicit about how your paper advances the field, but you want to be modest, because in my experience, reviewers like nothing less than people overblowing their own material. So be explicit in the sense of helping people understand how you understand the work and how it fits in, but be modest in the sense of not, as I say, overblowing your work. So I already covered this last point, so let's move on. I had an interesting experience working with a postdoc at one point where, she had given me this paper that started with this boilerplate about marine stratocumulus. And I said, would you read this paragraph? And she said, well, no, I know all that. And I said, well, so do your readers, so take it out, right? Writing is a craft. I have somebody back there who's learning to write. It takes effort, it takes work. So think about not just the science that you're doing, but the writing, the way that you're communicating that. And as we do in many practices, music or any other thing, the way to do that is to find people whose work you appreciate and try to figure out what it is that you appreciate about that work. So find authors that you like to read. Here I'm talking about the authors of scientific papers. And then read the paper with a critical eye to what it is that makes the paper work, like the structure. How is it that they are organizing the arguments? How is it that they are using language? How is it that they are constructing a story in a way that engages you? So read the paper with that in mind. Science is hard enough. Don't make it harder by being overly formal or stuffy. So be clear. When you have something to say, find the simplest way you can to express it. Use an active voice. And avoid artifice. So one of my favorite bugaboos is, this, then that implies that, then this. You would never use that in any other context, and it's distracting in a scientific context. So scientific communication is still communication. Be as clear as you can be. Science is not, I said this a little bit before about not overblowing your work, science is not advertising. Where you want to be very, very clear about the limits of what you have learned and what not. And breathless hyperbole is not something that readers or reviewers tend to appreciate. You may have imagined from your, seventh grade science class that papers are structured in a certain way, introduction, methods, right? That's just tedious, in general. And so use all of those, all of your structural information thoughtfully. right? So the title is the very first thing that's going to have somebody click and read the abstract, right? And the section titles are another way to advertise, to broadcast to your readers, to signpost how it is the narrative is constructed. So use all that material thoughtfully and actively. So let's move on. Yeah, I think we just said this. How to be more specific about how one constructs a title. They do want to be short, right? So 10 to 20 substantial words is not so bad. Keywords up front, I'm not a huge fan of this search engine optimization, but I think the point is that you are using this to tell Google and all of your readers, all of your potential readers, what the paper is about. And so you want to either state a finding or ask a question. And there's different, you know, in different subfields, there's different sort of norms the way people do this. In biology, I don't know if you read Nature or journals like that, but the title will often be a declarative sentence. This hormone, you know, drives that behavior, kind of a thing. Use current terminology. That's just part of being a a member of your active community. And remember again that the point of the title is to draw someone in to the next level of reading your paper. So let's go on. So there's three summary statements that AGU and indeed most other societies and journals ask you to prepare. Every single journal that I'm aware of asks you for an abstract. So that is for your peers. That's for your fellow scientists in your field. You don't want to rely too heavily on background knowledge and also you don't want this to age super quick. So you won't include a citation typically. You won't include acronyms, and you won't include abbreviations. Just in the interest of being explicitly clear about what the material is. Jargon is a word that we use to describe phrases or individual words that have come to mean some very precise thing in a very precise context. And in an abstract, that's less helpful, again, because the abstract will have a long life, again, because you're trying to reach beyond your immediate circle to the broader circle of your peers. Jargon is not so helpful, but key terms that will help people make the links between your paper and your mode of expression and other people and other people's modes of expression are, of course, helpful. Often AGU does this too, so we have these key points. You can think of these as being significant statements. And here what you're trying to do is explain to scientists in other fields, think of your biology roommate, your biologist roommate or something, what the paper's about and why it's important, right? So these are for people who are sort of beyond your immediate subfield, but generally, broadly speaking, in your field. So for NOAA, that might be, I don't know, all of oceanography or all of atmospheric science or all of fisheries, something like that. For most journals at AGU and many other journals as well, you're asked to provide a plain language summary. So that's really meant to be plain language. And a lot of scientists don't like writing these. I encourage you to think about them, to love them, roughly speaking, because journalists read these, and that's how a journalist will get in touch with you about your work. Politicians read these, right? Roughly speaking, anyone you know ought to be able to understand enough about your work to appreciate what it is you're doing. And so that's what these plain language summaries are for. When, you know, if you go back to this, one of the very first slides, we talked about our responsibility to communicate the science that we are doing to our fellow citizens and the people who pay our salaries. This is part of that, right? Being able to say, if I'm an interested high school student, can they go in and read this work and understand the flavor of what the problems are and what the work is addressing? So let's go on. This is the optimal, I want to talk about how to structure an abstract, but this is really at some level the form of storytelling. So there are many articles about how to write scientific material so that other scientists can read it. There's a 1992 paper called the elements of scientific writing or something. I can get that to you that lays this out very explicitly. But what you're doing is you're trying to write in a way that matches reader expectations. So you want to, one of the first things you want to do is explain what it is that's novel about your work. So this that's important and what's new. So that would go typically at the beginning, and that is the catcher, right? That's the thing that's going to stimulate the interest for people to read the next sentences. An abstract is terse. I forget, maybe it's 300 words or something relatively short. And so you don't want to provide a lot of detail. What you're trying to do here is, you know, like an IMDb synopsis, right? You take a 90-minute movie and you turn it into a paragraph and a half. That's roughly speaking what you're doing here, taking 20 pages and just telling people the high plot points. And that means not dragging out with, you know, descriptions of the scenery in the middle. And the other thing is you want to place this work in context. So on the one hand, you've done something new, and on the other hand, it fits into the broader context of scientific work. And you want both of those connections to be clear to every single reader, even only those reading the abstract, which honestly is what probably 2/3 of your readers will read. So let's move on. Love your figures. I don't know a better way to say that. Hannah, when I first started giving this talk, I had a different figure, and Hannah's replaced it with one that's perhaps even more beautiful than the one I used. I imagine that every single person here, without reading the paper, knows that this is a cloud. And those of you who are in atmospheric science can probably very quickly figure out that what this is showing is a cloud and the different forms of precipitation that happen in it. Figures, expressing yourself graphically with clarity and care is at least as important as expressing yourself in text with care. So there are many, many different ways in which you take care to express yourself. Color is a big piece of it. So you'll notice that these colors are this is a great example because, you know, there's distinct colors that show you the different scales, but there's another level which shows you the different kinds of precipitation particles, but there's another scale that shows you how many or how dense they are. So you've got two different levels of information. It's not cluttered at all. There's no, you know, grid lines on there. There's very little chart junk. We're not showing map projections, but, you know, typically if you're talking about a global mean, you want to show something that's roughly equal area, this kind of thing. So love your figures. There's tons of great information. I'm a big fan of Edward Tufte, although that probably dates me. But there's great information and resources about how to make figures that count and maximize information, and I encourage you to pursue those. Well, let's go next. I have a writer friend who once told me it's never about the writing, it's always about the rewriting. And it's hard to know how to rewrite after a certain point, after you have written and polished. It's really important to get feedback before you submit. The review process we'll talk about in a bit, you know, you're going to get feedback from your peers. And it's nicer to get feedback from your friends to start with. So go get an outside perspective, right? Someone in your office probably has the right perspective because, when you're in your office, because, you know, they know enough about your field to be able to parse it, but probably not so much that they're down in the weeds with you. Fellow students, fellow postdocs, your friends, your roommates, right? What you're looking for here is, does this work? Can you identify the story? What do you take out? Where did you lose me? You know, which figure did you have a hard time interpreting? And when you get that feedback, listen carefully. Right? And if something is not clear, it's your problem. Always it's the author's problem. It's never the reader's problem. It's never the reviewer's problem, right? So get that feedback, make it until the manuscript sings, and then you'll have a much easier time in peer review. So now let's talk about peer review. Before you submit to mine or any other journal, you want to be prepared. So you want to read the journal guidelines so that You don't send a manuscript that has no place in that journal to a journal because they'll send it away. You want to understand what the data policy is. And this is sort of an increasingly important aspect of publishing at any society. If you send in a journal that doesn't have the data supporting it in that's consistent with the policy, the journal will send it right back to you. You make plans to deposit your data and your code in some kind of research data repository. NOAA has one as an institution. If you are a cooperative institute there or otherwise, there are other research data repositories. Some of them are specific to disciplines. Some of them might be specific to institutions like NOAA or your university. But these are things that you should have a plan for and be in the middle of doing. I think at this point, every AGU journal will reject without review a paper that says the data is available on request from the first author, because that is 100% unsustainable. It's inequitable. There's a million problems with it. So be prepared ahead of time and don't hope for the best. ORCID is a, roughly speaking, it's a numerical identifier that's identified with you, no matter where you move to, how you, actually they'll change if you change your gender, they'll change your name with that. It's you. Oh, Hannah. Thank you. Sorry. And it's basically a numerical identifier for you and you alone, and you should get one. And indeed, if you are going to be the first author for an AGU publication, you have to have one of these IDs. But I encourage using it everywhere. Can you go ahead? Thank you. So pick the right journal. A lot of times these will be the journals you are already reading, of course. But you will have noticed that journal A has this flavor of papers and journal B has this flavor of papers. Every journal has a scope statement associated with it. We publish papers interested in, right? So think about that. Be self-critical. I know you want to publish in PNAS or Nature, AGU Advances, but those are pretty exceptional papers, and so calibrate well. Right. So how will you know which journal fits? Well, you'll read the scope. A lot of it, as I said, will be about the papers you're already reading and what journals you are citing in the paper that you are writing. You can often run this by peers of yours, and peers or as bosses or superiors or more experienced people or whatever. They'll say, "Oh, that's a paper that's suitable for that." And over time, and indeed journal editors do this, right? We are trying to make it clear what papers it is that we want to see, and we're doing that partly so that people will, think of our journal in that way, and partly so that we are different from other journals, so that it's clear that you would send your paper to my journal as opposed to JGR Atmospheres. Katie Rowley saying, or you can ask the NOAA Central Library to help you identify the journals that fit you best, which is also true. Your boss, your supervisor, or your other people in your institution. Okay, let's go ahead. I think James, the journal of which I'm the EIC, rejects about 40%. We're about the same as most AGU journals, about 40% of the papers that come to us. Probably 30%, right? So 3/4 of that is because somebody sends me a paper that doesn't fit my journal. So my journal is about modeling the Earth system in the sense of forward modeling. And so someone will send me, well, I have this great statistical model that describes this data. Well, I don't doubt that it's great, but it doesn't belong with me. And so these rejections can happen. What I'm describing is this assessment paper. I read the abstract, I might read into the paper, and I just say, does it fit my journal? And if it does, then I'll send it out for review. If it doesn't, it's not absolutely terrible, which happens almost never. I'll send it out for review. Before I even do that, though, my journal staff will do what's called a screening. So they'll look for compliance with the data statement. They'll look to be sure that all of the so AGU doesn't allow citations to in-press material. You have to have a DOI to cite something. So if you don't have a DOI, you can't put it in there, and they won't even forward it to the editor until that's done. So I would maybe distinguish between the screening that the journal staff do and where they might send it back to the authors, and the initial assessment that I or other editors do, where we're assessing the content of the paper and where we might reject it. And again, just to say that the very number one reason that the papers get desk rejected is you sent it to the wrong journal. When in doubt, send the journal editor a note with an abstract and a title and say, does this fit? Go ahead. So other reasons that you might want to consider picking a journal are, you know, these things that are listed here. At this point, I think all the AGU journals, and indeed most society journals, are published on about monthly timescales. Some journals are quick with review, some journals are slow. I have friends who publish in Journal of Fluid Mechanics. It's typically a two-year time frame. I think the publication time at most AGU journals is something like 80 or 90 days. You'll want to think about quality. I think for many journals, I mean, you probably have a sense that there's some kind of a hierarchy there. You would like to publish in journals which are both topical and reputable. And you know, there's no harm in sending in shooting high and sending your manuscript to a journal that is unlikely to accept it, that accepts very few because they're trying to be very high impact. But that might be a consideration when you prepare things. So the journal impact factor is a measure of how often papers in the journal are cited. It's a little bit like an H index. Everybody uses them and nobody likes them. But really, I think you will have a sense from talking to librarians and your peers about which journals are will attract readers and give you careful, thoughtful peer review. So let's go on. So I want to talk. Katie saying beware predatory publishing as well. And this is maybe I don't know whether Hannah's going to talk about this, but one thing to keep in mind is that publishing is, I'm going off script here, so forgive me for just a second, but publishing is a business, right? So roughly, I forget what proportion of the income of a society like AGU comes from publications, comes from fees that you pay to publish your journal. So of course there are predatory journals out there that are perfectly happy to publish anything as long as you pay them. And if you're publishing with a society journal or some other reasonably reputable journal, that's not an issue. But do be aware that you might have your work solicited for publication in some of these predatory journals. So peer review, is this process, so once I get the manuscript, I'm going to send it out for peer review as an editor. And what I'm looking for is some kind of an assessment of whether the work is worth publishing. So what the reviewers are going to look for is, is it true? Is it credible? Is it worth people's time, right? Is it important and relevant? Is it effectively communicated? So can people understand it? Is it novel? And I would add here, is it set well in context? Plagiarism, I won't even discuss. I mean, plagiarism, including repeating text deliberately from your own work, is just something that again, the editor won't ever see it. The journal staff will reject it out of hand if there's substantial reproduction. In general, why we go through peer review is to strengthen papers. I think some papers get rejected, some papers are not worth publishing, but that's not really what happens to most of them. The value of peer review in most cases is in helping you sharpen your arguments, communicate yourself more clearly. Maybe sometimes you'll find that your peer reviewers understand the context for your work better than you do, and they may help you see that.
Robert, have you lost the slides?
I have.
I don't know what happened. Sorry, one second.
It's okay. We're talking about peer review.
Are they back?
Yes, hooray.
Okay, there we go.
Right, so I would stress this fourth bullet here, which is that to me, and different editors are different, right? There are, because we're all just volunteers, roughly speaking. But to me, the point of peer review is to publish the best possible papers, right? So that doesn't mean that we can turn any result into gold, right? We can't, peer review can't do that for you. But it'll take the work and it'll sharpen it to be the best that it can possibly be. And that's both in the formal sense, the formal meaning the form of the paper, so that the writing and the figures are sharp and clear, but it's also in the thinking sense, the intellectual sense. You know, is the paper standing on the shoulders of giants, and does it point the way forward? And have people highlighted the work that's important? I'm not sure what you put there, Hannah, about the statement about diversity, equity and inclusion.
So this is a reference to, I'm sorry to interrupt you, a couple of different places in the process where we're adding more statements for reviewers, for editors, and also for authors to note AGU and Wiley's support about growing diversity, making sure there's equity and inclusion wherever possible throughout the process. So that's within the peer review process, that's within our assignment of editors, how we compose our editorial boards. We're looking to you, to the community, for more ideas for how we can increase representation across the publications.
Yeah. And so I don't remember this deck. Do we talk about, I'll just mention this now. And if it comes up in a slide later, we'll just skip it. One of the things you'll be asked to do when you submit the manuscript is provide names of potential peer reviewers. I know, Marie Curie, and I know Albert Einstein. What you should do, so I know the leading lights of the field. That's part of my job as an editor. What you can do in that moment is help me be more diverse, more equitable, and more inclusive by pointing me to people I might not know, by junior people, or people who publish less frequently because they're coming from developing countries. You can point me to these people when they have the appropriate expertise, and that helps me broaden the reviewer pool. It raises their visibility, I mean, partly locally within their institution, but also for me, right? So I and my peers will know who they are. So that's a very concrete step you can take that helps the editorial board along these axes. So let's move on. Maybe this is clear to you, maybe it's not, but let's just talk about the peer review process. So you will submit the article. As I mentioned, I will assess it. The editor will assess it. You know, is it comprehensible? Is it, novel? Is everything in order? Is it in scope? I might reject it, but that happens, except for scope, almost never. And then it will get sent out to reviewers. There's a step in between the assessment and the reviewers, which is that there's sort of a hierarchy of editors. So I might assign it to an associate editor too. So there might be two levels, editorial levels. It'll get sent to reviewers, and then the reviewers will provide reports. And often what a report will do is say, this is what the paper's about, and here's how it's strong, and here's how it could be stronger. And they will send that back to me or to the associate editor, and the associate editor and I together will make an assessment. And that assessment might be, we are sending it back. We could just reject it flat out. That happens rarely. We could say to you, it's not a bad idea, but it'll really take a lot of work. We're rejecting it now, but we hope you'll send it back to us. And here's what you would want to do to send it back to us. We might say, hey, it's in pretty good shape, but there's some fairly important things that need to happen. You need to do more simulations. You need to do more data analysis. You need to do more activity. That would be major revisions. And then you might have a fairly long time window, typically 6 to 8 weeks, in order to make those revisions. And sometimes it'll be, great job, need some polish. Here's some ways to sand off the sharp edges. And that is often a week or two. Those timelines are all pre-COVID, what I just said, by the way. And so after we've been round this loop, sent to reviewers, assessed, and further review needed enough times, and that's typically somewhere between 1 and 3, we will accept the paper and we will send it off out of the editorial system to production, which is the side that Wiley does, and then they will publish it. They will publish it. So let's go on. We talked earlier about soliciting friendly review. now we're talking about, you know, peer review, which is hopefully mostly friendly, but often not, but sometimes not. You want to think of feedback as a learning experience. There are reviewers, increasingly few, I'm happy to report, who will write unpleasant or hostile reviews. It's too bad. We don't need to be mean to one another. You want to take a step back and take all of the feedback as a learning experience. And again, consider that if something is not clear, it is your problem as an author. You may find that you've been unable to express yourself either in language or sometimes in math, particularly statistics. Go get help if that's what you need. Keep in mind, I think in my 6 years at AGU, I have never accepted the first draft of a paper. There's always been at least some revisions. So you just keep that in mind. Don't get discouraged. So if you're not going to be discouraged, you will be persistent. When you get this feedback, you answer the questions and you revise things, you know, as quickly as you can manage to do them well and carefully. Again, keep in mind this sort of framing for what peer review is about. Peer review is about editors and reviewers helping you make your paper better, and approach it in that light. I think it is fair to say that even after a round of hard peer review, you are one step closer to being published, and you should take faith in that, or take pleasure in that. So are there more slides, or is that the last one? Oh, right. This is just to say that, sometimes if you send the journal something that doesn't fit, we'll try and send it to a journal where it does fit. And so, for example, within AGU, we'll often send things between James, let's say, which is the modeling journal, JGR Atmospheres, sometimes to Earth and Space Science, which is a methodology journal, less frequently, but still happens sometimes to Biogeoscience, JGR Biogeosciences, or some Earth Surface, or one of these things. So this is about us trying to identify what's the best fit so that you don't have to, better to get this right the first time. All right, I believe that's all. Yes. So I don't know how many of you have been taking questions. I think we were going to ask Katie to highlight the most burning questions and then defer the rest to the end, because I haven't left Hannah very much time.
Awesome. Thanks, you guys. Okay, we did have a few questions, and one I'm going to clarify first is the NOAA Institutional Repository is for publications. It's not the data repository. Oops. So if you have data that you need to put in an archive, put in a repository, that is NCEI. So you want to be submitting that information there. And I'm going to try and get that link correctly in the chat for everyone. But the NOAA Institutional Repository, which is managed by the library, is for your publications. And if you do have data, please include that. We will link that, your publication, to your data set. And if you already have a publication in the IR and you have data that you haven't linked, let us know. We can link it after the fact. So just wanted to clarify.
Sorry, that's my fault. We had a little versioning problem. So we can also circulate the updated deck, which has the correct link in there as well.
Awesome. Other than that, our questions basically were, these slides are great and they want to, everyone wants to get their hands on them after the fact. So I'm excited to share those. We do have one question that I haven't had a chance to read through, but we have a moment. So I'm going to read through it. But while I read through it, would you guys like to go through those polls?
Oh, sure.
Okay. So I'm going to launch this first poll for everyone. Have you been published before? Okay, get everyone some time for that. Ooh, we're getting 60, 70% of everyone. Give them another second. Okay, I'm going to close our poll. We are at 75%. Okay, I'm going to share that with everyone. So yeah, a lot of people have been published before. 75% have been published. Awesome.
So maybe let's just do the one about reviewing.
Okay, let's grab the rooming and launch that for everyone. Have you reviewed? Okay, we're at just over 70% of our audience has voted. Give everyone another couple seconds here, and I'm going to close it. Share that with everyone. Also, 72%
so hopefully,
have
hopefully reviewed. That wasn't too much repetition or things people already knew.
No problem. Okay, I think we do have one question. Sorry, Hannah, I don't want to cut into your time, but I'm going to ask this really
no
quick.
Problem.
How do you deal with cases for where data cannot be made public? For example, administrative data on individuals or firms that was collected with the understanding that it remained confidential.
So that seems like a fairly specific question. So most of the time, the requirement is that some data be made public, right? So it doesn't need to be, it can be anonymized, it can be summary data, it can be, right? But so the point is a little bit about reproducibility and sort of being able to support what is in the paper with data that other people can analyze. So in practice, I just want to say that this is subject to editorial discretion. And if you could make a strong case about something to the editor, and say this is worth publishing, even if I can't publish the data, you know, you might be able to pull that off. But in general, we want to say, you know, you publish things at an appropriate level, you know, honoring people's privacy and so forth. But you publish data that remains useful for other people to be able to interrogate, even if it's not the raw data. That being said, there's like a whole office at AGU about this. And I would probably ask for help in a circumstance like that from those people.
Awesome, thank you. Okay, we have another question, but I'm going to shelve that until the end. Please take over, Hannah.
Okay, I'll make sure to leave some time at the end. Are you seeing the slides still?
Yes, we are, but we are seeing them in your PowerPoint window.
How about, is this better?
Yes.
Okay, I have no idea what's going on with PowerPoint, but just carry on and hope for the best. All right. So I'm going to talk a little bit about open practices and the decisions you'll make as an author, and then how that might benefit your research and getting your research out there. I'm going to go pretty quick through this and focus mainly on open access, and then touch on sort of maximizing your impact and promotion. There's more information here about open data sharing, which I'm going to skip because of time. But again, we'll share the slides, and if you have any specific questions, we're happy to delve into those. So first, you know, what are we talking about? So open research, open practices, it's about facilitating the transformation of science and research to be more open, accessible, efficient, democratic, and transparent. It's really driven by new digital tools, which make this sharing of critical science much easier, and for both professionals and for the general public. So why? Well, increased openness leads to more open research, obviously, but also more transparent and accessible research. It leads to more reproducibility. And one note on that, I know in the earth sciences, environmental sciences, the science itself can be kind of inherently unable to be reproduced. You can't kind of relive, hopefully, an extreme weather event or an earthquake. So it's really just about taking what you can share and what can be reproduced of the experiment that you created and sharing that, so that ultimately when someone has to go and do something similar, they're not necessarily having to reinvent the wheel. And last but not least is increased accountability. I think this is really critical with open research and one of its major benefits, that more openness, more transparency protects the integrity and the overall reputation of research. There are five major pillars in open research. I'm going to talk mostly about open access. And as I said earlier, we're going to skip over open data for the most part. But there are all five of these areas are equally critical. Open practices is about developing greater transparency in the communication process in peer review itself. open access. You probably know what that is, but that's about supporting access to the funded research as the final published version. Open data, Robert touched on this a little bit. It's about encouraging sharing and enabling reproducibility of data. Open collaboration, this is about helping researchers while they're producing their articles in the preparation and then also in pre-publication sharing, making that process open. So we talk a lot here about preprinting. AGU and Wiley have a preprint server called ESOR. There's a number of preprint servers that are across many different disciplines. It's becoming a real, it's really blossoming outside of just physics, where it started with archive. And then also open recognition and reward. So recognizing authors and researchers' contributions to the research in an open way. So there's badging here, and there's the credit taxonomy, which notes an individual researcher's actual contribution. That's growing in its prevalence across the research community. So I'm gonna skip this part because I don't think we're gonna have time, and move on to open access. So open access is all about the principle that the world's knowledge is more powerful when it's shared. Open access publication means that your research is immediately and permanently freely available online. And open access work is published with a Creative Commons license, which permits use, distribution, and reproduction. And we'll get into that in more detail in a minute. There are two routes to open access. When I say open access, for the most part, I'm talking about bold open access. This is the model that James, the journal that Robert is the editor-in-chief of, is under. This means that every paper in that journal is freely available, is immediately upon publication. Papers that are bold open access, they carry an article publication charge, an APC, and they also, as I said earlier, they have this Creative Commons license. We have two routes to gold open access. So we have kind of James' model, the fully open access journal, and then we have an option in our subscription journals to publish online open, which is a gold open access option in those titles. So that's an option that you might see in JGR Atmospheres or a similar title. The second route to open access is green open access. And in this model, the author can self-archive a version of their subscription article in an online repository, an institutional repository. This varies in the way that it's actually practiced, but for the most part, green open access means that the author can archive the submitted version immediately upon acceptance, although more and more it's immediately upon submission, including in the AGU portfolio, and the accepted version after an embargo period. And that's typically 12 months, but it varies, and it's also changing based on different mandates. But this work is published under the standard CTA, the Copyright Transfer Agreement. So a note about licenses. I just want to touch briefly on the Creative Commons license, because this is the license that Gold Open Access carries. So in this model, there are three different kinds of Creative Commons licenses, but across all of them, the author retains the copyright, and the public is allowed to reuse the content, with some distinctions amongst the three. So Katie suggested that we note a little bit about how this might work for a NOAA employee, because it is different for US government employees. And if you've ever published, as 65% of you have, you've probably dealt with some of the complexity here. So first and foremost here, not everything that a US government employee publishes is necessarily subject to this difference in licensing. It has to be something that was part of your work as a government employee. Assuming that's the case, then there are two potential scenarios. If all of the authors are US government employees, then our system, the Wiley Author Licensing Service, will automatically generate the right license. And then just one author has to sign in that system and the entire license is correct for you. And it means this license will show that your work is in the public domain. The second scenario, and this is where there's often complexity, is that not all the authors are US government employees, and so two people need to sign. One, the US government employee, and the other, someone on behalf of the non-government authors. But thankfully, our system will produce two licenses, and you can sign online now to take care of that. But we're used to answering questions about this. If you have any confusion while you're publishing, don't hesitate to reach out to Wiley Author Services, who can help you throughout this process. So why publish Gold Open Access, and should I publish Gold Open Access? I think if you have the funding, this is a great option for you. because it leads to the widest possible dissemination of your work. So Heather Piwawau published an article about the benefits of open access and assessed how prevalent open access really is. And they found that about 30% or 27.9% of all journal articles are open access. And interestingly, papers that are freely available get 18% more citations. And then this probably is no surprise, but articles that are published open access are downloaded 97% more often. They found this in their study, and we see this come to bear across our portfolio as well. So publishing gold open access increases the reach of your work and has the potential to boost the citations. I mean, it's always kind of a function of the paper itself, but obviously having that accessibility makes a big difference. So now you've published, you've chosen the right route, the right journal, you've published open access possibly, you've shared your data. How do you promote and maximize the impact of your research? I'm gonna do this really fast so we have a little bit of time for questions. I know Robert said he's not a big fan of SEO and search engine optimization. I understand that it's kind of a nuanced thing. It kind of feels like you're gaming Google a little bit, but there's some pieces of search engine optimization that I think are really critical. You need to SEO your title, your abstract, and your keywords. And there's ways to do this that make it so that it's still kind of the best way of communicating your science, but you're also communicating it essentially to the search engine. So you need a title that includes and leads with these important keywords. And then you want your keywords to be search term style keywords, because this is what's going to get pulled up in the search. In that abstract, you want to place the essential findings and keywords right in those first two sentences of your abstract, because only those two sentences actually display in search engine results. And then this is the one that I think people find to be a little bit, I think it's actually a change in how we traditionally wrote abstracts, but you do want to repeat those keywords in the abstract 3 to 6 times in the most natural way you possibly can without making it look like you're or sound kind of odd or as if you're being repetitive. We've included an example here of one that's really kind of a best practice. There's lots of different ways to do this, but this will help your work to be discovered. And then really quick about maximizing your impact. So as I said, you want to set yourself up for success. This means SEO, also getting an ORCID ID. This is required for most, for all the AGU journals, for many journals at Wiley and most journals across publishers. It's a persistent identifier for you. That means that your work will always be linked to you. Whether or not you change institutions or you change your name, it always stays with you. But the big things here for you to remember are to share your work. Don't be shy. Share your paper on social media, use some of the tools that Wiley has or other publishers have. We have Wiley Article Share and content sharing services. And don't forget to update your institutional profile with your latest publication. Be proud of your work, share it as much as you can, and then talk about your research and talk about it a lot. Network, present, make the most of virtual conferences. AGU's meeting is coming up in a few weeks. I'm sure a lot of you will be there. Again, don't be shy. You are the best advocate for your research, and you're the one who can share it better than anyone else can. And then content is king. So we recommend creating a short story, even of your paper, using lay summaries, infographics. We have lots of tools here, but this is another way to show the community what you've done. And so just briefly here, we have a lot of different tools at Wiley to help you do this, and we'll send the slides around with the link here so that you can find those tools. And with that, I think we have 5 minutes left for questions.
Thank you so much, Hannah. Okay, I'm going to look back at our questions. We do have the one from earlier that is for Robert, if he wants to hop back in. Okay.
Sorry.
No problem. Okay, so this question is, how do you feel about double-blind reviewing or non-blind reviewing? Can an author request blind reviewing?
I have been trying, I think double-blind reviewing is a great idea. I think there's enough academic experience now that we know that that will lead to more equitable peer review. I have been trying to get this happening at AGU for quite some time. I have some particular, Sonia Legg is one of my associate editors at Princeton, and she has been really pushing for this. People raise objections. I think that AGU will probably try and implement this sometime soon, but they'll try and implement it in a way that is helps them see whether it's feasible. So people raise objections. I keep saying we're scientists, we should just gather data. But there's basically just some institutional inertia. I hope that you will see AGU doing this within the next couple of years, at least on a trial basis. And I do think, to think about it the other way, if I understood the question right, that actually it's important that peer review be anonymous. Because often you have difficult things to say to someone. And so even when sometimes it's probably obvious who is reviewing the paper, I never sign my own reviews because I would rather that authors think about it as being feedback from potential readers and from their community and not get into some personal thing with me. So I don't know, hopefully that answers the question.
The second half of that was, can the author request a blind review, or is that not common?
It's not possible yet at AGU. I hope that it will be. You should write to Matt Giampaolo, who is the head of publications at AGU, and tell him that you think it's important, because I think it's important too.
Great, thank you so much. I think this next one is for you, Hannah, or possibly both. Is there some evidence that research presented at conferences gets cited more?
Ooh, that's a good question. I don't have any evidence on hand about that, but I can look into it and see. I would guess that it probably is. There probably is some impact from presenting at a conference, but it's hard to know if it would be impact on citations or downloads. They're very different metrics, and often we see that a lot of the kind of promotion will really drive downloads. Driving citations is down to, on some level, kind of the impact of the science to the community.
Great, thank you. And thank you for those answers. We actually don't have any more questions, which is amazing. Is there anything you skipped over in virtue to getting to the questions that you would like to pop in?
Maybe I could speak to what Hannah was saying about openness, which is that I find in my own work that this has been a valuable thing to aspire to. So, you know, when I publish papers at this point, what I aspire to do is put in a repository software, Jupyter Notebooks is how I tend to work, but whatever, the software that someone could download and just literally run and reproduce every figure in my paper. And so what that shows you is, like, where do you go get the data? How do you process the data, right? I think that it helps. Sort of ease the barriers to reproducibility. And so I think if you imagine that your goal is in regards to openness is to provide enough software to provide enough context that someone could literally reproduce every paper in your figure. It's not a bad place to start anyway.
Thank you. Hannah, last words?
I like that. I think we should end on that note.
That sounds great. I'm gonna check on the questions. The last question is, can we get this PowerPoint? And yes, you can. We'll make those changes about the data repository and get this out to everyone who attended. And a reminder, we recorded this. So if you enjoyed it and you wanna pass it on, it'll be on the library's YouTube channel in the next couple hours, or at least by tomorrow morning. Thank you everyone for joining us today, and we'll give you back a single minute of your day. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.